Hello, and welcome to the Evelyn Y. Davis Studios at the National Press Foundation. Self-driving cars aren't a thing of the future, they're here already. Cars can park themselves, stop themselves, and drive themselves down the highway. But what's going to happen the first time you look out your driver's side window and see a car with a snoozing passenger and no driver? Will you be impressed by the technology or freaked out? That's what we're here to talk about today, and we have three experts to do so.
The National Press Foundation is a nonprofit dedicated to helping journalists cover complex topics with depth and accuracy. We serve journalists in the U.S. and around the world.
I'm Chris Adams, Director of Training at the National Press Foundation. The topic today, cars, the kind that drive without you. Known as autonomous or self-driving vehicles, they could be a big part of our transportation future. Or maybe not. Could it be hype, even a little bit? I'm joined by three experts from the transportation world. Blair Anderson is the Undersecretary for Policy at the U.S. Department of Transportation. Joan Claybrook, former President of Public Citizen, a consumer watchdog organization. And Paul Brubaker, President and CEO of the Alliance for Transportation Innovation, a trade group. Welcome all. So what we're going to talk about today is the technology of self-driving cars, the safety, regulation of them. Right now, our viewers are going to, we're going to show some video from Uber about its recent experiment in Pittsburgh in which they were sending self-driving cars through the streets. And we'll talk about that a little bit more later on. But it shows cars weaving through city streets and traveling down highways. We're also going to take questions from viewers. And if you would like to ask a question, the question form is on our web browser just below the video. You can also tweet us at NatPress, and as questions come in, I'll work them into our conversation. So the main reason we're here today is to talk about the federal role in all of this. The government's interest starts right at the top, and in September, President Obama published an op-ed in the Pittsburgh Post-Gazette, the main newspaper there, talking up self-driving technology. He said, "Safer, more accessible driving, less congested, less polluted roads, that's what harnessing technology for good can look like. But we have to get it right. Americans deserve to know they'll be safe today, even as we develop and deploy the technologies of tomorrow." So at the same time, the Department of Transportation, your agency, your department, Paul, and the National Highway Traffic Safety Administration put out guidance for companies developing the technology. Blair, can you give us an overview of that guidance?
Right. Thank you very much, Chris, for having me here today on behalf of the department, on behalf of Secretary Fox, to discuss this topic. I think it's something we're very proud of, the work that we've done over the last year in particular. As we look forward, you discussed some of the kind of benefits and why we're very excited about what we're working on today. There's clearly this technology has safety potential down the line. There are 35,092 folks who lost their lives on the highways in 2015. And there's a lot of opportunity there, clearly, where new technology could come into the marketplace and help save some of those lives. So traditionally, the department and NHTSA have been a very reactive regulator in terms of oftentimes, as new technologies come forward, we would watch them mature in the marketplace, research them before we got to a place where we had standards. And then even after the fact, most of our enforcement activity would then become kind of reactive. So with this document, we're trying to kind of get out ahead of that. Secretary Fox very much wanted us to go from kind of a reactive stance to a very proactive, where we essentially kind of put this guidance, which we look at as really a framework for a discussion, out early so that we could provide some level of direction to industry, to innovators, such that innovators are innovating within a culture of safety. So throughout the document, we kind of lay out expectations of what we think needs to be discussed, dealt with, researched. As people design these types of vehicles, how do they start to build that kind of culture of safety into the discussion as they're going through the design framework? And then we lay out a number of places where, as we look towards the future, where we might need regulations, where we might need new authorities to ensure that this technology has come on safely. So as I said, it's really the first step in kind of taking a proactive approach. to making sure these safety technologies enter our roads safely.
Okay, and let me just you mentioned NHTSA there,
right?
And so our viewers know NHTSA is what we'll be using saying all webinar today. National Highway Traffic Safety Administration, NHTSA.
Right. Yeah. NHTSA. So, kind of for the broader picture, NHTSA is a agency within the Department of Transportation. So I apologize to the viewers that I will probably jump back and forth between the two, but it's all kind of within the broader department who's engaged.
Okay. And so just tell me very briefly, not getting too deep in the weeds, but this is guidance. What exactly does guidance mean, and how is a guidance different than a regulation and a rule in that process?
So I think I use the phrase, this is a framework to begin the discussion. This is guidance. This is putting out kind of our expectations. And it is providing some level of guidance towards the general public, industry, developers, of where we see issues and how we expect to move forward in the development of this technology. It's also kind of foreshadows areas where we think there might need to be regulations. So it's does not have the force of kind of a statutory rulemaking process. That's a process that will take years, many years to get to. And so with this document, what we're trying to do is say, we know we'll have to get there at some point, but very early on, we want to kind of lay out where we think the issues that need to be addressed are, and kind of set an understanding of where we as a department, we as an agency, expect to move forward on.
And give me one example. Like, what is an example of one area that you can foresee there'll be need to be regulations down the road?
Mm-hmm. So I think within the document, we lay out a number of next steps. Mm-hmm. One is within the document, we set this 15-point safety assessment, which is kind of a novel new tool. And it lays out 15 areas from cybersecurity, testing and validation, operational design domain, essentially 15 different areas where we expect the automaker or the developer to kind of take into account and during their design process. And so this letter right now, we're going through the Paperwork Reduction Act process, but right now that would be something that's voluntary. And I think we lay out in our next steps that we expect at some point to go forward and potentially pursue a rulemaking on that to make it a mandatory reporting requirement for manufacturers.
Okay.
So that's one of a number of different places.
Okay. Now, Joan, you're a former administrator of NHTSA, but you had a long career at Public Citizen afterwards, which is a major consumer watchdog mm-hmm. organization, and you're also involved with a couple of safe driving coalitions right now. Before the guidance was released, you and others wrote the president to say, this is a letter from a coalition mm-hmm. of groups under the banner of the consumer watchdog, thus far, the administration's policies on automated technologies have been developed in the shadows, and the administration should not succumb to Silicon Valley hype about the miracles of autonomous vehicle technology. Autonomous vehicle technologies hold the promise of improving safety, but that promise can be only realized after a thorough testing and a public rulemaking process that results in enforceable actions. So, talk to me a little bit about what your concerns are. And what's your view, big picture, what's your view on the guidance that came out?
Well, I think it's a big nothing burger. I use a very common term to summarize what I think about it. The concept of the National Traffic and Motor Vehicle Safety Act, which was passed 50 years ago, mm-hmm. Was a preemptive one, and it was to prevent injury and death on the highway. And this guidance document essentially leaves it up to the auto industry to decide what it's going to do, how it's going to test and evaluate its vehicles. And it ignores the public rulemaking process, which is a very public documentation. It involves proposal by the Department of Transportation, comments by industry and consumers and others, suppliers, dealers, and then a final decision by the department on a particular rule that governs the performance of the vehicle. Mm-hmm. Now, Blair is incorrect that the agency has waited until innovation has been achieved and then regulates, because if you look at the airbag, which is the most important safety system that the agency has regulated, that was proposed before airbags were on the highway. And research went on for at least 5 to 8 years before that. So, and it was the court case at the Court of Appeals here in Washington said that the concept of this regulation was to promote innovation. And that's exactly what these standards do, because they're performance standards. They're mm-hmm. not design standards. So there's no limitation on the options that the manufacturer has, their performance. And they have to achieve a certain performance. So our view is that the Administrative Procedure Act, which governs regulation, has a whole public process, public dockets, and all the information that the decision for a rule is based on has to be in the public domain. And the companies can't have private meetings with the department without putting a notice in the public docket. And the agency's decision has to be based on the public docket. And that was made very clear by the Supreme Court in a case in 1983 dealing with the airbag, where the mm-hmm. docket was more than sufficient to authorize a rule on airbags. So we feel that this is an industry-dominated process, that the companies are absolutely delighted about this, because everything says should. It doesn't say must, and it doesn't have any penalty. A company can do what it damn well pleases and doesn't have to conform to what the department has laid out at its 15 points. And it's going to be secret. Everyone says, oh, no, this is going to come in and it's going to be public. The companies, if you know anything about NHTSA, they always stamp everything confidential. And then there's a whole big process about whether or not it's confidential. So the public's going to be excluded from this. And these cars are very complex. They're going to come on the highway. The whole process here is complex.
Right.
Whereas the safety standards are not that complex. Once they're issued, it's very clear to the public that they have to be complied with. And that's not going to be the case here.
Okay, so we'll come back to some of this in a bit with Blair. But I want to turn to Paul. So, you know, I get the sense that you have a slightly different take on things.
Yeah, but you can tell by the body language.
Yes. So, but I want you to, first of all, I want you to tell me about your Alliance for Transportation Innovation.
Yeah.
Who do you represent, and who funds you?
So we represent the technology industry, innovators, mostly folks from the realm of networking, wireless communication, cybersecurity, consultancies. The folks who are sort of working with the ones and zeros that enable a lot of the technology that you see in the transportation space. Everything right. from, you know, pipeline pigs to autonomous systems. We get, you know, obviously the membership fees and sponsorships, and we also do some research programs for on a fee-for-service basis. So we're a nonprofit social welfare organization. Dedicated to accelerating the deployment of technologies that will dramatically improve the safe and efficient movement of people and goods. And okay. it's in that order.
Okay. And so, and you also had some history back with the DOT, with the Research and Innovation Technology Administration.
Yeah.
That was a division of
yep.
DOT?
Yeah, the Research and Innovative Technology Administration, which is now at the Assistant Secretary level within the Office of Secretary of Transportation.
And okay. who funds his work?
Oh, the members. My members.
The members. The yeah. companies.
Yeah. The companies, and we've got some association members as well.
And do you have automotive manufacturers in your association?
No, I do not. No, we do not.
Okay. So a couple weeks ago, you wrote in The Hill, a Capitol Hill newspaper, mm-hmm. About your reaction to the guidance. The abstract said all the right things, and we joined the stakeholders in celebrating the document as a solution to our problems, but when we dug deeper, we discovered problems for our solutions.
Yes.
And explain that a bit.
Yeah, allow me to put that in some context. So first of all, I want to commend Secretary Fox and Administrator Rosekind. I think they did an exceptional job with this, with the guidance. The department, I believe, pushed as far as they felt comfortable pushing, giving the amount of input that they had on the document. Now, where we had issues wasn't with the 15-point assessment, and we were really grateful for the clarification of the state role vis-a-vis you know, regulation of the systems or mandating certain design features and things like that. It was good to see the department pull back their rightful jurisdiction and clarify and offer model guidance to the state, so that we were very, very happy with that. Where things got a little tough for us was when we saw the department, and I want to be fair here, because the department has kept open a comment period, a 60-day comment period, and we're grateful for that, because at least this is getting the dialogue going. And where we're going to chime in is really related to sections 3 and 4. The fact that they reaffirmed their support for the current rulemaking tools, and I wouldn't have expected anything different, to be honest with you, but the rulemaking process that Joan cites is broken. It was invented 50 years ago. It's just not responsive. It's not agile for the 21st century. In fact, I've been collaborating with Dr. David Bray, who's the CIO at the Federal Communications Commission, on, he's proposing creating something like an ARPA for artificial intelligence and apply it to civilian agencies and the regulatory process itself, so that we can begin collecting data, begin doing doing data analytics, applied data science to the regulatory rulemaking process to expedite it, to make it faster, more agile. Certainly time for public comment, but let's define what we mean by public in this rulemaking process, because in our experience, and I came to Washington in 1988 for what I thought was a six-month assignment with the GAO, and I've been here ever since. So I've been at this a while and had spent some time on Capitol Hill and watched this process work, and was a deputy Assistant Secretary of Defense at DOD, and I've seen this from a lot of different angles, right? And I've been out in industry. And I will tell you that this regulatory process isn't a public process. It's rarely a public process. It's the purview of lawyers and lobbyists, and they run roughshod over what is essentially an insider process. And I think that's why, you know, you see voters frustrated with everything, is because this is generally a quiet insider's process. And I watched this process take place with a public meeting in D.C. and went out in Stanford, and frankly, I didn't see enough innovators at the table. And we want the innovators to have a voice, both in terms of reforming the Federal Motor Vehicle Safety Standards, because they have over 230 individual references to human drivers. Mm-hmm. It mandates design features. It's not simply a performance standard. It is design features that specifically presuppose a human at the wheel. And that is going to fly in the face of level 4 and level 5 self-driving vehicles. Then we look at the future process, and the thing that we find troubling about that is there's a pre-approval process that they hold up as an example, and I think it was the only one that they had to hold up, which is the FAA's and then the Food and Drug Administration, and both are woefully broken. Both are woefully inadequate. As somebody who's dealt with both of those, I can tell you they're ineffective, they take years, and it's just not agile for what we need to drive innovation into the infrastructure and into the transportation system.
Okay, so I mean we've been talking a lot about the process here. I want to get on to the technology itself and some of the broader safety issues at play. But for reporters who are covering this, I mean, is there still an open comment process, and how do reporters out there actually tap in and review how people are commenting? And are the comments that are coming in, is that the tip of the iceberg of all the interaction and conversations you have with folks? Or if people are talking with you, are they showing up in the comments?
I think, so kind of taking a step back a little bit from your question, and kind of I think the way Joan kind of characterized this is this was like the final statement from the department, that this is the extent to which we're going to regulate automated vehicles. This, I think, that mischaracterizes where we are in the process. We're literally framing the discussion, and in the policy document lay out a number of places that we recognize that going through the formal rulemaking process is going to probably happen, and that there is likely going to be performance standards down the line once we've gone through the research. We have enough research and data to be able to make an appropriate standard.
Can I jump in here too? You also said that this is an iterative process. I mean, you left the door open to updating this annually, if I read that correctly.
That's true, but wait a minute. Cars can still be manufactured today, tomorrow, next week, next month, next year, 2 years, 5 years, before you get around to doing anything that's more than a framework, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so it's not something that really addresses some of the key safety issues involved. It's very voluntary by the manufacturers, and they should do this and they should do that, and they don't feel like it, they don't have to.
No, though, as you said, the way the Safety Act is set up, the auto manufacturers are able, under the statute and the regulatory framework that's been in place for a long time, to put these technologies on the street. And so what we're doing with this policy is trying to lay out that framework, provide some level of guidance now at the front end as they develop this, and as we go through the process, go through the research, go through the validation, to get to a point where we could put very solid regulations in place that both allow the innovation to move forward, but also provide, without constricting it within kind of a presupposed box, but also provide and help us get to these safety benefits safely. Kind of back to, I know I jumped away from your original question, and I apologize.
It's
taking us down a different rabbit hole, but I did want to kind of get back to it. And I think in the creation of this document from the beginning, we tried to make it as public as possible, that we went out and we held a couple public forums, both in D.C. on the West Coast. We invited people to please come, put comments in there. Also, if they wanted to talk to us, come talk to us. And we very clearly, with this document, I think as Paul mentioned, intend for it to be iterative, and have laid out a formal public comment process for the next 60 days. I have done events, most recently, earlier this week in California, to kind of solicit more feedback. Because
right.
we recognize that the department does not have all the answers. We need safety advocates like Joan chiming in. We need people from industry. We need folks from think tanks, from academia, from the legal world to provide their feedback. That's what's going to make this document a lot stronger, so that we do have a very responsible kind of regulatory framework as we move forward.
Okay.
Well, but
so
the problem is that there is no discussion here about what vehicles can be put on the highway today. It is true that there's a self-certification system in the statute, and that self-certification as to the regulations that exist. And here we're going to have a dramatic change in the way cars are made.
Mm-hmm.
And there is no process here laid out for making sure that the safety of the vehicles is going to be clear to the American public, and that they have to self-certify to anything at this point. They just should do this and they should do that.
Mm-hmm.
And there's no promise that the information that's submitted will go into a public docket. You know, have you had meetings with industry? Of course you have. Have you had memos written and put into the docket what those meetings are about and what they've said? I don't think so. And so the rulemaking process, the Administrative Procedure Act, requires you to do that so that there is a protection for the public. As to the sub rows of communications, if you would.
Okay.
And so one company comes in and says, well, we just can't, you know, comply with all this stuff. I'd just like to comment on the process.
Very briefly, then we have to move on to, but go on.
Okay, well, I'd just like to comment on the issue of the regulatory process being broken.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, well, so the industry loves a broken regulatory process because it means it's not going to happen.
Right.
And
those who benefit from the status quo love a broken regulatory process.
That's right, and consumers don't benefit from a status quo,
okay,
particularly with these new cars that they're suddenly going to be confronted with, and they're trying to get on top of it and understand it, but the regulatory process is broken because industry throws roadblocks in the way. They demand more information. They threaten to sue, and so the agencies are very cautious about not making a decision unless they've got all the information, all the data. And then there's a roadblock, in, as you've just mentioned, Blair, in the OMB, the Office of Management and Budget, where you can't ask more than nine companies for information, and you have to go through this Paperwork Reduction Act, which I was there when it was passed. It was never promised to be a blockade to moving forward and getting information for the rulemaking process. So the process can be fixed.
Okay.
Okay, and so you can't say, well, regulation doesn't work, therefore discard it. That is not sensible. And so I hope that maybe Paul will make some proposals for improvements in the regulatory process as opposed to opposing it.
All right, Paul, we'll come back to this. But I wanted to come to you next because I want to start talking about technology. I mean, the rulemaking is an important part of it. Right. That's what a lot of reporters will be covering. They'll be watching what DOT and NHTSA is doing going forward. But I want to talk a little bit about the technology itself. Mm-hmm. And it's no accident that the president's op-ed ran in Pittsburgh because what's been going on there. Can you give me a sense of, there was this Uber experiment in Pittsburgh. Right. There's a White House Frontiers conference in Pittsburgh. Give me a brief description of what was Uber doing in Pittsburgh?
Yeah, so what Uber's doing right now is testing a vehicle that has autonomous features. Mm-hmm. I want to distinguish because this whole notion of self-driving on autonomy has, it means different things to different people. And when you see it written, it's very confusing. And SAE has a good guide in terms of, you know, the five levels of autonomy. But it's not sufficient. And if you go talk to the public about five levels of autonomy, their eyes glaze over and they look at you like you're nuts. And I think it's the number
one.
Much
less SAE, which you didn't say who they are.
Society for Automotive Engineers. Okay. It's industry. It's an, yeah. Anyway, I'll get Joan excited again. And by the way, I do have to say something about Joan's comment about...
Back to the technology.
Okay, we'll get back to the technology, but I do want to talk about this ill will thing because it drives me nuts on the part of industry because I see some of it, but I don't see exactly what you're saying. So back to the technology. I mean, for the last 20 years, even longer, vehicles have become increasingly automated. And whether it's whether it's anti-lock brakes or whether it's having tire pressure sensors, they're becoming rolling computers essentially.
Right.
And it's even more than that. Now you're putting tons of sensors on there, and they're rolling sensor platforms with tons and tons of code. In fact, the average luxury vehicle has over 100 million lines of code, and you look at a 787, and it has about 18 million lines of code. Mm-hmm. There is complexity there. And a lot of that complexity is born out of some manufacturing processes and underlying technology, network technology that is dated, that they're just putting more technology on, and that increases complexity and potentially some risk in the design and creates some vulnerabilities, which have been written about ad nauseum, and in my opinion, mostly overblown to scare the public. And no offense to the watchers here, but they do sell newspapers and get people reading these stories.
We're all for that, by the way.
Well, you're all for that. And so am I, and I like the print edition. I like the way it smells and feels in my hand. But the underlying technologies, they're developing at a fever pitch, mm-hmm. and it's interesting to see, like, a lot of our members are developing these technologies, but the design cycles are sort of out of sync with the ability to deploy the technologies quickly. And in terms of data, you know, it's not like they don't test this stuff. Mm-hmm. It's not like they don't have a sense as to how the software is going to behave, and they use a lot of very advanced technologies and a lot of tools in order to mimic operational environments. Right. So it's not like they're, but what Uber's trying to do in Pittsburgh is collect operational data in a real world environment. Newtonomy's doing it in Singapore, same type of thing. They've got a fleet of taxi cabs in a very defined geographic area, and it's to collect operational data. And I don't know if you saw what Tesla just announced yesterday, but it's a very interesting strategy in order to collect operational data that will improve the artificial intelligence around the vehicle. So there's some really neat stuff going on.
Now, why? I mean, I actually used to live in Pittsburgh. It's a hilly city with bridges and tunnels, a very confusing street grid. I mean, why are they doing this in Pittsburgh? Does anybody have an idea for that?
That may be the reason.
It's precisely why.
Yeah, just because the level of complexity will help.
Right, but remember, in the Uber test, they have two drivers sitting right there, ready and willing and able to take over if there's any problem. I completely agree with that. I think that that's exactly the way the kind of testing should be done. I just don't think that they should be carrying passengers in the back seat. They just don't do it without the passengers.
Well, I think in Pittsburgh, too, you also have a community where you have a lot of kind of technology talent, too. Mm-hmm. With Carnegie Mellon there, there's the brain power there to really work on this. And Pittsburgh is not by any means the only place in the U.S. where you have that kind of critical mass of of talent, but it definitely attracts.
But this speaks to proving out the technology is where you test.
Right.
You know, it does us no good if you test everything in Southern California where it's beautiful and we've got one season, right?
Right.
So, you know, show me a test at Fort Kent, Maine in February and you'll get my attention. You know, you got to go through some harsh environments and you really have to test it. So, you know, you started off saying, is there hype? You bet there's some hype, but there's also some real promise and some real development of some interesting technologies that are going to get us through this. And you know, we'll talk a little later on where we are exactly in terms of self-driving and what the future might look like. But you know, you got to recognize that it's not perfect, but there are levels of autonomy that are being tested and proven, and I think we build on those lessons and build safety and around it. And I think the benefits are just going to be enormous.
I think it's going to be incremental.
Right.
And I think that's the way the American public wants it. Okay. So that, you know, first you have warning if there's a car on either side of you, and you have the automatic emergency braking systems and so on. And so eventually then you improve from that. Mm-hmm. And if it comes gradually, then the public can accept the changes and understand them and become familiar with them.
So here's what I'm going to recommend that everybody watching this does, and everybody around this table do. If you haven't done this, I highly recommend it. Go test drive a Tesla. And turn on the autopilot. Just go do it.
Yeah.
And it will, and then come back 3 months later and do it again. And you will notice the improvement in the software. And they do these over-the-air updates, and it's just amazing technology. Mm-hmm. What I'm concerned about, what our members are most concerned about, is that we inject some regulation into the mix that prevents the ability to take advantage of some of these modern tools. And frankly, they're doing encryption and authentication better than 90% of the other folks out there, because it's a safety of life issue. They recognize that. They're not fools. That's why I had an issue with the ill will thing. And I'm sorry, Joan, I don't mean to jump on you about this.
What's the ill will mean?
Like, you're presupposing that the industry would enjoy killing people, and I don't subscribe to that.
I never said
that.
No,
I know. I'm putting words in your mouth, but my
don't.
Well, let me be clear about what I mean.
Okay.
So I think you're presupposing some ill will on the part of the industry that they will try to get away with stuff. And my position is these are technology companies. Their future absolutely depends on it. The auto industry is morphing more and more into technology companies. These vehicles have to operate. This isn't, you know, a 1964 Corvair. This isn't unsafe at any speed. This is a whole new world. This is ones and zeros. These are computer platforms, sensor platforms, highly sophisticated materials with people who really know what they're doing. This is no longer the land of rotary dial telephones and carbon paper. This is a different world that we're dealing with now. So the regulatory structure that was created to make sure that crashes are survivable has to sort of morph in its thinking to regulate cars that no longer crash or rarely crash.
Okay.
And it's a different mindset.
Well, but the fact is on the technology that these are somewhat experimental. They need to be treated as that. They're not ready to go necessarily. Tesla is a perfect example of a company that pushed the envelope and called their system an autopilot. And people believed it. And it was not. It was still in the experimental stage.
So
I don't have any opposition to new technology. Believe me, I have been a pusher of technology in the automotive field from day one. But I think that it has to be done in a way that does not put the public at risk. And for example, let's just talk about some of the problems. Some of the problems are snow and fog and going up hills that are too high, and so you can't see on the other side. There are lots of problems with little tiny animals, and then there are choices. Mercedes, which just put out a statement saying that if you have to make a choice between hitting a pedestrian or protecting the occupants in the car, they're going to protect the occupants in the car. Well, a lot of people may not agree with that. So these are the kinds of things that need to have a public debate. They need to be an open process. And that's the reason I focused on that.
But they have to be informed and not emotional. The problem that we're having is a lot of these red herring issues are out there, like these moral choice arguments. You've got to understand that the level of situational awareness that these vehicles have already and are going to have, and Tesla's actually got some data on this, and I wish they'd be more public about this, but they've got, and Tesla's not a member of ours, by the way, but Tesla has data that shows that when there's clear lane marking, that holds the road better than, and holds the lane better than a human. There's data on that. There's
data on that. I don't doubt that, but clear road marking, okay. How many roads in America don't have clear road marking? Lots and lots.
Well, maybe that answer, maybe that suggests a solution to some of the capability issues that we've got. But there are scenarios that you can lay out where it's not perfect technology. I mean, the Florida crash was a case in point.
We'll get back to that in a second, I think.
Can I just finish this point on the Florida crash? But people forget that there was speed involved, and there was a person who was pushing the technology limits far beyond where it was supposed to be pushed. And is autopilot the right name for it? I don't know. They called it cruise control. I mean, and there's this unfortunate scene Anchorman 2, where they're executing the cruise control and the RV flips over and everybody gets a good chuckle out of that. But you can't, where I grew up, they've got a saying, you can't cure stupid. And I'm sorry, but if somebody's going to push the limits beyond the technical capabilities.
Yeah, but we're not talking about that.
Well, there was speed involved.
There's always going to be some people who do that.
And don't forget that the truck pulled out in front of the car.
Okay, so I want to kind of.
And by the way, you know what? That truck did not have a regulation for a side prevention going under the vehicle like they do for the rear, and we've been trying to get that for 20 years out of DOT.
Well, if this technology gets fielded, you aren't going to need those regulations.
That's
because
right. If.
Okay, I want to ask
when.
I want to ask a kind of a big picture question. A while ago, you mentioned Carnegie Mellon in Pittsburgh. The Wall Street Journal. This is a big picture. Where is the technology today, and what can consumers out there expect to see on the highways soon? A professor at Carnegie Mellon, Raj Rakumar, was quoted in the Wall Street Journal, a story about this, in which he was reviewing some of the aspirational views of where the technology stands. And Professor Rakumar said, these statements are aspirations, they're not really reality. The technology just isn't there. There's still a long way to go before we can take the driver away from the driver's seat. I want to ask kind of a short answer question of how long will it be, given the state of technology today, how long will it be until people are going down the highway and a good number of the cars around them are being driven by autonomous vehicles? Is this something 5 years, 10 years, 50 years?
Mean
down
no driving.
There's a lot of ways to answer that question.
Okay, pick the shortest one.
Pick the shortest one. Well, we'll see. I guess by default, whatever I say is the shortest. So I think kind of Raj's statement and then a little bit of the conversation you've seen here between us today kind of really highlights the fact that there isn't one agreed upon answer at the moment.
Right.
Kind of as Joan mentioned, she thinks, and this is not an opinion that's unique to you, there's a lot of people, there's people in the auto industry who think the technology is going to progress incrementally. And then there's other companies who have banked it on skipping some of those in-between steps, that they view those as kind of risky and want to jump straight to eventually getting to self-driving vehicles. As Paul mentioned earlier, Tesla came out with their announcement yesterday, and as part of that, I'm sure he's very ambitious in this, Elon Musk said that they will have self-driving vehicles by the end of 2017. Mm-hmm. Ford and other companies have targeted 2021. So there is by no means agreement within the industry in terms of what, both how the technology progresses and also when it gets to that final point. As it gets rolled out, I think it's not going to be just all of a sudden there's self-driving vehicles everywhere. You have the simple little fact that the average car on the road is 11 years old, give or take. So there's going to be a progression as these things roll into essentially the fleet mix. And they're not going to roll out everywhere. They will probably roll out in very defined areas immediately through kind of very defined kind of business type operations. So it's going to be, the technology may progress incrementally or it may kind of take evolutionary steps. But the actual rollout of it will probably be incremental and kind of hitting different parts of the population, the geography, places where it makes the most sense first.
Okay. So let me ask you two, and just a very concise answer. Is it going to be one generation or two generations or less than that before, you know, before it's kind of commonplace to, you know, to purchase a self-driving car?
And I would say it's going to be at least 10 to 15 years.
Okay.
I completely disagree with what is their prediction. There's a lot of money being invested in these vehicles and research and so on, and they won't pay back fast.
Right.
And so they want to push having some of their vehicles out there that are self-driving cars.
Okay.
And there's one other issue, which is that companies like Google think that to allow the consumer to take over control of the driving process when there's a problem is worse than relying on the car itself, because you're out of date, you're reading a newspaper or whatever, and suddenly there's a problem, and mm-hmm. so you're not connected. But I do think that that's a huge issue for a lot of people, and everyone knows their computer goes on the blink,
right.
And this is a whole set of computers. So you can the public, 65% of the public are not in favor of this at the moment,
right.
And they may be more as time goes on, but. It's a real burden for the industry to show that they can have these cars in the next 2 years.
Okay, Paul, well, how long do you think it'll be?
I think there are examples of it today where you've got a level four.
Until it's commonplace.
Until it's commonplace. Well, but this is important to the answer, okay? So you do have testing going on right now in closed environments mm-hmm. where you've got level four self-driving vehicles that have no driver, no brake pedals, none of those design features, but they go 25 kilometers an hour. I mean,
right.
They're limited by speed, they're limited by mm-hmm. course. And that's part of the incrementalism. That's what's going to grow. And as you probably are aware, Mary Cummings from Duke University says 15 to 20 years before it becomes fairly ubiquitous. It depends on what you're looking for. In all environments, level five, ubiquity, it's going to take at least a decade.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Let me ask you a question from a viewer out there. I think I'll ask direct this at you, Blair. Besides regulations that we've kind of been talking about, are there any restrictions on who can be present in a car at a time? For example, what would be the restriction on a minor being in a self-driving car alone or with somebody? Does that person need to be a licensed driver? I mean, is that the kind of thing that, I mean, when will those decisions be made?
So at the moment, that is a decision that has kind of been made on the state level. Mm-hmm. To date. I think as you've looked at the way states have approached this, they have kind of looked at whether you need to have a licensed driver in the car at all times, whether they need to be behind the wheel, or whether as the technology progresses, whether you could have an instance where there's not a licensed driver. This question of children kind of has come up, and mm-hmm. I'm not aware of anybody taking kind of from a legal standpoint, a stance that you can have a kid or you mm-hmm. cannot. As you look down the line, you could make the argument that if you have, if the state allows a vehicle without a driver in it, does it matter if that person who is in the car, who's on license, is a minor or is an adult? I think these are the questions as we look towards like the liability questions, the ethical mm-hmm. questions that kind of need to be continued in the public space about where people are comfortable, where, and I expect different states will land in different places.
Okay, so just want to remind, thank you very much. I want to remind our viewers, if you have a question, submit them in the form on the website or through Twitter at NatPress. We only have like 15 or so more minutes. I want to talk about some safety issues and then some other kind of broad economic impact issues. The safety is a big component of this. A recent RAND Corporation study report concluded autonomous vehicles have the potential to significantly mitigate the public health crisis of auto crash deaths by eliminating many of the mistakes that human drivers routinely make. To begin with, autonomous drivers are never drunk, distracted, or tired, and those are all factors that play a big role in auto accidents. And their performance may also be better than human drivers because of better perception, such as no blind spots, better decision making, because of more accurate planning and complex driving, and better execution, faster and more precise control of steering, brakes, and acceleration. So that's on the good side. But that same study said it's tough to statistically establish the safe driving record of autonomous cars. RAND concluded Autonomous vehicles would have to be driven hundreds of millions of miles and sometimes hundreds of billions of miles to demonstrate the reliability in terms of fatality and injuries. And the time necessary to do so would be, quote, an impossible proposition if the aim is to demonstrate their performance prior to releasing them on the roads for consumer use. So I'm going to go to you for this one, Joan. Has the safety of self-driving vehicles been demonstrated, and what would it, assuming no, what would it take to do so?
Well, no, they haven't, because they haven't been driven those hundreds of billions of miles, which is what it would take. And, you know, for the current motor vehicle safety standards and also other provisions in current cars, the auto industry has huge testing facilities. They test endlessly. Some of it's done by machine. Some of it is done by driving. That has not occurred with the autonomous cars. And I do not think that the Department of Transportation should allow them on the highway until they have met some basic minimum safety requirements. That's my dispute with this document. Right. This document is a very aspirational, this is going to happen, and here are some guidelines, and here are some things that you should answer if you're going to head in this direction. It's all very vague, and there's no opportunity for a real public process, as I said before, that allows the public to identify, you know, what safety has been achieved and the minimum safety requirements that they have in order to be sold to the American public. And so that's a real problem, because as Paul says, they're advancing very rapidly in some companies not. There are lots of different suppliers. It's just not the major manufacturers. It's tech companies and other kinds of automotive suppliers are doing this as well. So it's a vast industry that's investing in this. And I think that they should have some basic requirements that they have to meet before they can put those vehicles on the highway. And the public wants that, because they don't know how this technology works. They don't know what's behind it, what's behind the dashboard, so to speak. And so they want something to rely on. And the thing to rely on is a federal rule. And I think those federal rules could be significantly improved in terms of getting them issued and done. And it's, as I say, the arguments that occur over that are ones that should be on the public record. And that's, by the way, for reporters. I had a reporter talk to me the other day. He said, well, they're going to submit all this information on these 15 different areas. And I said, don't you bet on it. Mm-hmm. They're going to submit information, and then two-thirds of it's going to be stamped confidential. And then it's just going to have to go through this humongous process of trying to figure out what is and what isn't confidential. So I'm an advocate of new technology. I want to see the improvement in safety on the highways. I've worked for that my entire life. And so this is something that, to me, is very, very exciting.
Right.
But I want to see industry behave and meet the standards for safety that the public wants.
Now, I mean, getting into public perception is kind of what I want to do next. And this is both public perception and the way the news media reports on self-driving technology and access involving the cars. Mm-hmm. There was a recent story involving a Google self-driving car. It wasn't a major crash, but the first day stories was about, you know, Google self-driving car in an accident. And later on, the later stories were it was there was human error on the part of the other car that caused it. But I'm curious what kind of impact episodes like this have on the public. The AAA recently did a poll in which they found that only 1 in 5 U.S. drivers would trust an autonomous vehicle to drive with them in it. Women are more likely than men to be afraid of the new technology, and baby boomers are more likely to be afraid than younger generations. And that also deals with a question from one of our viewers. And I think I'll go to you with this, Blair. Once self-driving technology becomes more sophisticated and it eventually goes mainstream, what would you say to convince the inevitable slow adopters of the reliability of a computer completely controlling the driving experience? So talk to me about where the public is on this. Is the public confident in this, and how long will it take generationally for people to get confident with it?
I think there's two parts to that question, or there's two ways to look at it. There's one: is the public comfortable with that they could get in a car today and it will take them in a self-driving mode to wherever they want to go? And that kind of infuses into a lot of the discussion that's out there. And rightfully, I think the public recognizes that the technology has not gotten to that point today. Mm-hmm. But the flip side to that, in which I think it's lost when those polls are discussed, is there's a lot of public excitement out there about what this benefit, what the potential for this technology down the road, what it could become in the future, both from a safety standpoint, and I think we all share kind of what we would love to see that safety benefit to be. We may have some disagreements about how you get to there, but we all want to get to the same point. And there's tremendous opportunity that people are excited about from a mobility standpoint of just having that opportunity. You look at millennials and kind of the way they approach technology and car ownership, and whereas maybe they're not comfortable in getting in that car today, I think they see that potential and they have that excitement. To the person's question about kind of confidence and reliability, I think to a certain extent it is just seeing the technology as it moves forward, as it's validated, as it's tested, getting experience being in the vehicle. But I also do think there is a recognition, at least on our part, that as a department, as you look towards the future, not everybody is going to necessarily have to be in a self-driving vehicle 10 years from now, 20 years from now. You're always going to have somebody who has their 1965 Lincoln Continental that they want to be driving down the road.
And they should go drive that on National Park Service land. Seriously, I mean, the way we view this is it's a three-legged stool. I mean, you've got the public, you've got industry, and you've got government, and government at all levels. And it's not just the Department of Transportation that plays in this. You've got NIST that's issuing cybersecurity standards. In fact, in December, they're going to come out with some really interesting standards that will be related to this area, which we're very excited about, that will help guide and harden the cybersecurity. But, you know, the public perception is the very reason why my organization today actually released its framework for the next administration, a series of recommendations. And we don't presume any answers to this stuff, but we lay out some big questions. The number one question is, how are we going to earn public trust around self-driving to accelerate the path? The second one is, how do we ensure that we have reliable underlying technology, which is critical? Because, you know, everybody will admit that it is not there in all weather conditions and all situations. And then the third is cyber. And then fourth is law, regulation, and policy. And we've got some other things in there that are related to, you know, just kind of going down the line. You're looking at, how do we compress that cycle where we've got a shared environment, where you've got people driving the 69 Camaro with the brand new shared self-driving vehicle that people are subscribing to? Because frankly, I think personal car ownership is going to eventually fade off in the next decade and a half. And the future of mobility is going to be, you know, shared, autonomous, and electric. And that's just the way it's going to be.
Now, what that actually kind of plays into one of our questions from our viewers. Since not all people will have self-driving cars, who is at fault in the event of an accident? If the person in the self-driving car technically isn't driving, is the manufacturer responsible? In the eyes of the court, who would be responsible for damages?
Well, I'm a lawyer and have looked at this a little bit, and my view is that if it's a level 4 or 5, the manufacturer is going to be responsible. Mm-hmm. And if it's a level 3 or less, and these levels are 4 and 5 are fully autonomous, pretty autonomous, and those below are either partially autonomous or not at all, it's going to be the driver, but it's still going to require the evaluation of the particular crash. And one of the exciting things, which I hope you'll consider working on, that I am very interested in, is having the transmission of data from the crash itself directly to the DOT database, so that it'll be a fully operational, online, up-to-date database. So you can look at these crashes and evaluate what needs to be done to improve the car, or what kind of training drivers need, or what kind of advice they need in terms of driving these vehicles or not driving these vehicles. And right now, it's an antiquated system, to use your word.
I've got some thoughts on that. We definitely should talk.
It's a very antiquated system and the police don't even take pictures of the crash. Now they have cameras for crime. They don't take pictures of the crash, which would substantially enhance the ability to collect data and understand deficiencies in vehicles and also in driving.
I'd love to kind of piggyback on what Joan just said, because I think you hit a point that I think everybody's incredibly excited about, but we, from a departmental safety standpoint, the opportunity for kind of data sharing here, essentially group learning within the industry, within the manufacturers, is incredible. And that essentially the experiences of one, you get exponential benefit out of that. You've seen, or at least in our policy, one of the areas we've highlighted that we really want to spend some time, and it's kind of one of our early focuses, is how do we get this kind of more robust data sharing, anonymous data sharing system in place. The FAA has had great success over the last 20 years with this ACES system, mm-hmm. where it was very unique at the point, but you have within a very competitive industry, a kind of third-party entity was set up to share kind of data within across the industry, and everybody as a result was able to learn from the experiences of each other. And from a safety metric standpoint, they've seen the industry as a whole get much safer. And I think with the technology now and the amount of kind of the over-the-air updates, stuff like that, and just the general software, there's a lot of opportunity
here. There's tons you can do with that. And it will require some data scientists and some people who really know what they're doing. But I think I like the idea of an independent third party that has a certain
That's
oversight.
Called NHTSA, and I
know. We're going to go have lunch and talk about this, because I think we are probably more alike than we care to admit at this table. But we'll talk through this, because I think there's some really good things here that we can do.
All right, so we only have 5 minutes. I have one question for you, Paul, and then we'll one or two other questions after that. When we were talking before, you mentioned the challenge of, quote, predicting the unpredictability of human drivers.
Yep.
It's an interesting phrase. Tell me what that challenge means.
Yeah, so this shared, I think the biggest risk that we face is the shared environment, where you've got the fully autonomous vehicles, and then you've got, you know, people like probably my 16-year-old son who will take risks that he shouldn't take and are completely unpredictable. And I'm watching, you know, and talking to a lot of my friends in the artificial intelligence world and the neural net world. And what's interesting is they've kind of tackled the ability to even recognize an aggressive driver versus a non-aggressive driver. What's weird is if they get schizophrenic on you. Mm-hmm. And those are very difficult problems to solve. In fact, they're probably going to be the long pole in the tent. We can, you know, we probably have, I'm sensing from talking to folks that we probably have the technology and the ability to solve probably, you know, 90% of those scenarios. But that 10% and getting to that last 10%, it's going to cost a lot of lives, I'm afraid. And, you know, we lose 96 people every day. And every day we delay in getting to what I consider the nirvana of self-driving is costing lives. And that transition period, you know, one of the things that we lay out in this strategy that we just released is there something that we can do to compress that shared use environment from a public policy perspective? Are there public policy triggers that can help us get the existing, you know, inventory off the road and move more quickly toward a fully self-driving? And I'm not a Republican. I'm not a Democrat. I've served in the Clinton administration. I've served in the Bush administration. This is not an ideological thing. This is a good government thing. And I think government has the ability. Indeed, I think they've got a moral obligation. You just look at the preamble of the Constitution where it says, you know, promote the general welfare. Well, if this isn't promoting the general welfare, I don't know what is.
Okay.
That's why there should be safety standards.
All right. So let me ask, we only have time for one other.
It's in the Constitution.
One other question. We haven't talked much about
it. I'd give you ammo before the end of the session.
She's a strict construction.
Yeah.
You know, we haven't talked much about the economic fallout of this, and we don't have time to go into great level of detail on this, but you know, this will have a major impact on insurance rates, mm-hmm, because mm-hmm. if the cars are safer, there'll be fewer insurance claims. What are, just very briefly, Blair, what are some other potentially positive and possibly negative economic impacts of this? And we only have a couple minutes, so pretty quick.
Well, I think, let me say, kind of with the conversation, so with the policy document, we're looking very much at the how do you regulate the vehicle insured safe? Kind of throughout the department, the Secretary Fox has been really adamant and has really pushed us to look at broader than just kind of that very narrow, what is our responsibility, but what are the impacts of these technologies, mm-hmm. and are there other places across the department? So just yesterday we announced this advisory committee on autonomous or automated transportation. the Secretary Fox really wants this to be part of the, to be a venue to have this kind of broader conversation, because right. there's clearly, if these vehicles and Uber gets to a point where they're deploying these, could have an impact on the on kind of the employment community, the taxi driver community, as autonomous technologies get into the freight system, they could have there's millions of truck drivers around the country. There's also all the ethical issues. How is that going to reverberate through the insurance industry mm-hmm. if all of a sudden there are fewer accidents? The flip side is we don't really know how that's going to line up with how what is the value of the accident. So there's a lot of questions that, to a certain extent, we could talk about, and we want to have these conversations through this new advisory committee. Okay. But we don't necessarily, until you see the data, you don't know the answer.
Do you have any consumer advocates on your advisory committee?
We opened it up to nominations yesterday, so okay. if you want to put your name for it, there's nothing against you nominating yourself.
Okay. So with that, I think
Paul should be on.
I want to thank all of you. We have to close this down now. We will give all of our viewers and the reporters out there who are covering this issue information about your organizations, your website, so they can kind of get in depth your positions on this issue. Mm-hmm. But I want to thank you very much, and I want to thank our viewers. So thank you for joining us today from the Evelyn Y. Davis Studios at the National Press Foundation, where we make good journalists better. Today we've heard from three top experts about the future of self-driving cars, which are coming very soon to a highway near you. I want to thank Blair Anderson, Paul Brubaker, and Joan Claybrook for sharing their expertise with us. Find more webinars and reporting resources at nationalpress.org, and follow us on Twitter at NatPress.